You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon. Welcome. This is Theater 100, and I'm Bill DeLuca, and I'm pleased to invite you to our look at the unique forms of film, television, and theater. That's what our Theater 100 class is basically about this semester. We are trying to create a very interactive environment here. That's my background in theater. So you'll see there's our phone number. Feel free to join us and call 1-800-339-1193 and give us some comments or questions that you'd like to share with us on questions that we bring up in the program. This is basically a look at the different related performance areas of television, film, and theater. And today's main topic, unfortunately, I have to go through a lot of what the course is going to be about for our students. So we deal with course requirements, and we're going to look at some of what is there on that syllabus. But the second half is going to be focused on film shots. So we're going to begin our investigation of film techniques. But this is very much an interactive environment. So if you feel like calling, that's great. If you feel like going online and doing a comment to askdhtvlive@gmail.com, we'd love to hear from you. In fact, the technical folks in the studio will forward this to me. I have monitors out here that I can see your comments, and I can add those to our discussion to some extent. So feel free to join us today. I'm looking forward to your commentary. Basically, to help you perhaps respond to something, I'd like to have a focus question usually in every broadcast. So today, let's focus on how you perceive watching theater is different than watching film or television. There's certainly lots of complicated differences in terms of how it's put together, but the art of watching it, how is that different? What is your experience like watching a film or television production, and how is that different than watching something in a live theater? So that's a little bit to get you started. Just a little bit about me so that you're aware. I'm actually a stage director. I was trained in New York and went to Yale School of Drama to study directing. I had studied it at Villanova University in Philadelphia. Went to New York as an actor and found myself fascinated with directing because I love working with designers, I love working with playwrights, I love working with actors. I'm not any of those three things exactly, but that's why being a director is ideal for me. In my 10 years as a freelance director in New York City, as well as 3 years of teaching cross country before I finally got here, first at Cal State Long Beach and then at Cal State Dominguez, I've been very fortunate to be able to direct shows that are classics like Twelfth Night or Antigone, but probably most delighted to teach a lot of the contemporary works that are coming out from new playwrights like Lynn Nottage, who just did a wonderful production on Broadway that won the Pulitzer. And we're actually thinking of doing that here next year. It's called Sweat. So new plays have always been a fascination with me, as well as plays like David Henry Hwang's M. Butterfly, Diana Son's Boy. These are plays that focus on more contemporary issues, focusing perhaps on Hispanic American or African American issues. In fact, speaking of which, as a director, I must say, we have a unique show that is opening in our next month here, February 23rd at Dominguez Hills, and it's called Before It Hits Home. I don't know if we can give you a look at the poster that we've actually created, but this is a wonderful play. It's about a man who has contracted AIDS and the impact that it has on his family. It was written by Cheryl West back in the early 90s, late 80s, when AIDS was a difficult problem. So it is tracking this disease and its impact on all families, actually, but hopefully you can come and see it at our Edison Theater, which is the smaller theater inside our university theater. And these are the kinds of shows that I've really enjoyed doing here. In fact, at Dominguez, I was able to do some research on Hispanic American theater and found out about teatros. These are theaters that are designed to help improve society by the use of theater. Teatro Campesino was the first one. So I created Teatro Dominguez here, which has been a kind of unique addition in the last 25 some years. And we've done shows in elementary schools. We've done shows just recently, for instance, we had students write plays about issues that are relevant to high school students, and we did those in our university theater. So you'll hear a lot more about me, about Teatro Dominguez. In fact, if you're curious to get more on me, you can go to our Blackboard site and click on the faculty button there and go to my website and read about Teatro Dominguez and some of the work that we've done here and in our local communities. So yeah, I've had quite a career as a stage director, and here at Dominguez, I teach playwriting, I teach theater history, I teach a variety of classes, but they're my main ones, as well as directing. And I'm able to help students develop their own creativity and self-expression. So I'm very blessed in terms of the many opportunities I've had teaching here, as well as directing shows. 2 years ago, I guess it was just a year and a half, I did Hairspray, which was an amazing musical for us to do, quite a challenge, but it went over very well. So I've kind of done a wide variety of types of shows, and that's one thing I love about theater is the vast variety that is there. Okay, so just general information about our course. We are looking at these three performance forms of theater, film, and television. And even though the main focus probably is going to be theater, because obviously I'm a stage director, how they differ is a lot of what we're going to look at. And basically what we track is the elements of production. A lot of what we want to see is how performers do their performances well, how a director learns his or her craft, how playwrights write their plays. And this includes the many designers who do the work on sound or makeup, as well as scenery, lighting, lighting up, obviously. So we look at the design aspects, the technical aspects. There's a great deal of work to be done by a stage manager or by a technical director, all the board operators. So we're going to look behind the scenes, if you will, in this class to see how it's done in these three areas of film, television, and theater. And hopefully, it will develop for you a little bit more of an appreciation of the kind of artistry that goes into the work and what these unique, often unrecognized talents are able to do. Also, do realize, I know that you haven't seen a lot of theater. Theater is very expensive. We're used to seeing films. We're used to seeing, videos on our phone. But I am hopefully going to encourage you to try to go out and see some live theater, even though it's more expensive than most of the film opportunities that you see. And obviously, watching television is something that comes quite easily to most of us. But I'm a great believer that theater helps to create a dialogue with the community who is watching it. There's something about the live aspect that contributes to a learning process. So you'll hear me talk a lot about that. The broadcast that we're going to watch, all the way up to broadcast number 15 on May 8th. The structure of these are pretty much the same. I kind of do an introduction. I will do some announcements that help the students who are in the class to do their best work. But one of the things I like to do is start with a little bit of the history of theater and film and television. Why is that? Because I think it's an attempt to show how they are reflections upon who we are. It's a bit of a mirror image, if you will. So even though you may be looking at 17th century theater forms, you're still analyzing, are these values here with us today? Even though we're looking at how maybe a French Renaissance community was held together in the 1660s. So to me, history is a great teller of not just what it was like then, but what we are doing now. So a little bit of section on history. And then obviously the focus on the content of the reading. So my students are going to be looking at the 13th edition of Edwin Wilson's The Theater Experience, which is a wonderful textbook. I think I have an image of that that we can bring up just to show. There it is there. The 13th is not, has only been out for a year. I will tell the students in the class, if you want to use the 12th or the 11th, that's fine too, but just be careful you don't get lost when you're supposed to read a chapter on acting, let's say, and it's a different number than what was in the 13th. Everything on our class is designed for the 13th edition. So if you use the 12th, in fact, I have a chart I will show you that shows you where the different chapters are so you don't get mixed up with the numbers. I often will use the second half of the broadcast after a short break to maybe invite a guest to talk about performing today or directing or cinematography. So we'll have guests. We also look at 5 films in the course of the class. So we often will focus on one film in its, not its entirety, but we'll look at segments of it. And during the whole broadcast, I like to take questions from either your phone calls or logging onto the internet. So we try to make it a discussion. So feel free to go online to that askdhtvlive@gmail.com to simply write a response or post a question, or you may feel courageous and want to use the phone and we'll bring it up and have a conversation right here in the studio. So feel free to use that. Before we talk about the class assignments, because I know that's a lot of what the students need to hear, I do want to kind of introduce the topic of what we're going to look at. And one of the best ways of doing that is to ask ourselves, really, what makes theater unique? What does draw us into it? Why does it work so well? I think one of the things is immediacy. We're looking at something that is happening right now. It is not canned, it's not pre-recorded, it's alive right now. So that's one thing that actors will actually talk about, immediacy, making it look like it's happening right now, that it hasn't been rehearsed or performed before, but that it's truly live. There's an interesting scholar, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, who said that there's a willing suspension of disbelief that we engage in when we are in a theater. In other words, we know it's fake, but we share this illusion that this is the first time it's happening. We may know, in fact, that this show has performed 36 times before and we're watching the 37th performance, but when we watch it, we willingly give up this disbelief and join in and not only follow the plot to understand what's happening, but emotionally we're charged up, either laughing or crying. It's amazing how we will get into it so deeply. So there's a willing suspension of disbelief, which is a great phrase to show how an audience member has to participate too in a show, especially a live one, where your participation has to do with your imagination. So when we get to our chapter on the audience, we'll talk a lot about that. Another thing that makes theater unique is the communion between audience and actor. Obviously, that is something you're not going to get in a film or television production, but when it's live, there is a sense that obviously the audience is listening intently to what's going on. Many people don't realize that the actors are very aware of what's going on with the audience, that it is a genuine communication. There's a circle of action and reaction that's going on there that makes it even more live. You're not just watching a videotaped production. It's going to always be the same. Audiences actually can affect what happens on stage. So that communion with the actor and the audience is very unique. Another thing is the fact that we love entertainment. Why else do we go to a theater or even a film or a television show, but to get some sense of entertainment? That is perhaps the real draw there. And entertainment, as much as it might sound lighthearted, is sometimes a good piece of healing for us too. Some people just really need to go and have a laugh. So it can serve some very important functions for us. Also, collaboration. The theater is unique in that you're watching a community of artists that are putting together a show, and usually there are a number of them on stage. You're watching a group in action. And that kind of collaboration is something we all engage in every day, so we're seeing that mirrored as well. As well as the mere fact that life is a double. It is a reflection of life. There's no stronger reason perhaps for the appeal of theater than the fact that it mirrors what we go through. And we may be vicariously living through what a character is going through in a show. So that is what draws us. And after all, the amazing part of what makes theater unique is that the focus is on human beings. It's not like we're watching a painting. It's not like we're watching a sculpture. We're watching an actual human being on stage. We are the subject of the drama. So it's something that's very easy to relate to. If you were to watch Paul Robeson doing Othello, which he did in the early 1940s and became famous for overshadowing so many other great heroes in the performance, you would see that this is a human story that we are seeing. It almost becomes a kind of focus that becomes all compelling for us. So yeah, why do people go to the theater? Oh, there he is doing Othello with his Desdemona. Why do we go to the theater? Storytelling has for all time been a delightful experience, listening to heroes and heroines attack problems that face them, overcome what may have been an insurmountable obstacle. So we need these stories to believe in ourselves. Storytelling, as again, entertaining as it can be, still also offers a feeling that we can survive and overcome. We also love the skill of execution. If you're watching Paul Robeson performing, you are enjoying this phenomenal voice that he had. And since he was, before he became an actor, he was actually a member of the early National Football League. So for those of you who are going to watch the Patriots and the Eagles go at it at Super Bowl, try to imagine this huge man who was quite wonderful in his eloquence, his speaking, his singing. But he was a powerful, I think he was running back before he went into theater. But I bring this up only because sports, when we watch sports, we are fascinated with the skill of someone being able to hit this long three-point jump shot or do a long jump. And you can see their body cover so much area. And even the distance that they cover in the jump is also kind of mirrored in the style of how their body is moving. So there's a great artistry when you watch sports. Well, obviously that's the same in theater. You are watching the superb quality of vocal work as well as physical movement. These actors train quite a lot in dance and gymnastics. So they are eloquent in how they not only speak, but move. So the artistry of the execution is another reason why we go to the theater, as well as getting fresh perceptions on life. And that is perhaps one of the most unique things about plays, is that you learn about cultures that are different from our own. So there's many reasons. That's one of the exciting reasons for me at Dominguez Hills to do plays from a wide variety of not just ethnic situations, but we have Stop Kiss, for instance, we just did was a unique play that looked at hate crimes against lesbians. We've done plays about AIDS, like Before It Hits Home. We have so many issue-based plays that we focus on, not just a play about Cesar Chavez to kind of show a cultural hero. And that kind of diversity brings great, fresh perceptions. That's another reason why we go to the theater. One final reason that I want to offer, which I think is unique, is that it provides a spiritual experience, which sounds strange because obviously we're going there for entertainment, But we've even had writers from the past, most notably Aristotle himself, who wrote the Poetics back in the 4th century BC in ancient Greece, and commented about how comedy brings out the worst image of ourselves, whereas tragedy shows us with great nobility, shows our best side. He also, in that, pointed out that when you go to the theater, you experience a catharsis. Not only tragedy, but comedy allows us to kind of purge the emotions that have been troubling us by watching someone else's experience. So in a way, there is something of a psychological connection to when we watch a show. And you know yourself from watching films and television and theater pieces that are so compelling emotionally that it does provide a unique spiritual connection. When we look at the history of theater, we'll see how it was very much based in ritual, based in religious exercises. So theater does have that in its origins, and many still believe that that spiritual connection is still there. Well, anyway, that I just wanted to kind of introduce you to the topic, the world of where we're heading with this class. But I see we actually have a comment from someone who's logged on to our website. Thank you very much, Roberto. Roberto is saying, this is actually my first online class with a live feature, and I wanted to try this out and asking a question. I wanted to know, what do you enjoy the most about theater? Well, thank you, Roberto. That's a very perceptive question. I think perhaps one of the things that I am most drawn to is, I guess, the sense that when we go to a piece of theater, we go to it to be moved. A lot of people think that theater is about seeing great sets, and it is. I mean, there's great artistry in the costumes and the scenery and how it's staged. And I mean, if you go to see a show like Wicked, you're just amazed at what they've been able to accomplish just visually to enthrall you. But I guess I feel that the real heart of theater is to move an audience, to make someone feel something in the audience. And to me, it's those shows that present a character who is, well, I mean, Wicked does have that. I'm not saying Wicked doesn't have that, because the Elphaba story is one that many of us can recognize, that feeling of being left out, of being the outcast, of being the outsider. And she is able to learn to trust herself and defy gravity. I mean, that number, which is so technologically wonderful, people are in the audience just with goosebumps, because they feel that sense of power when you can say, hey, I took on a challenge and I accomplished much more than I thought I would able to do. And I've learned a lot about myself. So to me, being moved in the theater is really what it's all about. You can have a show that's delightfully entertaining in terms of the show aspect, but if it's not compelling in some way, if it doesn't draw your emotional connection in some way, if the conflict of the show doesn't somehow just take control of you, then it's not working. So Roberto, thank you for that question. I thought that was wonderful. That is what I most enjoy in theater, but I enjoy a lot more. I think you'll find that out, but I appreciate that question. That was wonderful. Unfortunately, now I have to segue into the ABCs of what our students have to do in the class. So I'll probably spend a good 20 minutes with this, and then we'll take a break and come back and look at some examples from film clips that will show us the basis of how we're going to analyze film in this class. But just to kind of clear the air in terms of what's coming up, let's get a look at the website. So if I can actually draw your attention, for instance, here to our first page, this is what you see when you go on to our Blackboard site. I don't know if you got a chance to look at this. This is actually an image of a 19th century theater with all these drops that are flown in from the fly space above it. So it was a unique way of doing theater. But anyway, here is the announcement pages, so feel free to read information that is posted here. How to view the broadcast is here as well, if you're watching on cable television or if you want to watch it on the internet. And one other thing down at the bottom here, I put this, I doubt that you can read this But I hope that you'll go to the page. But let me just say, this is an online class. And one of the things that I can tell you for sure that I hope Roberto is going to understand is that outside of this broadcast where I'm talking to you face to face, you are going to need to get emails from me. I'm going to be sending you emails through Blackboard, but the emails go to your Toro mail, okay? And if you don't check your Toro mail, then we've got a little bit of a problem. So this section of the announcement pages gives you how to set it up so that your Toro mail goes to your personal email, okay? I think you'll be relieved to know that there's some important information coming that you're not going to miss. So that's in this opening getting started page. I want to bring you first to the syllabus. So on this page here, you see this button here, syllabus. I don't know if you can see that. Is that on clearly there? So anyway, click on syllabus and it'll bring up a page that looks like this. Hopefully you can see that. But the syllabus gives you all the basic information that you're going to need. In fact, it is something of a legal document. It is, here's the information on me. Here's the description of the course. Here's our textbook again, The Theater Experience, Edward Wilson. And please read through all of these learning objectives so that you know what our focus is and how we're going to assess this learning that you do here. But things like the required materials, let's look at some of the requirements here, for instance. The Wilson book, we've already talked about that, but I do want to talk a little bit about the fact that in the 13th edition, we have certain chapters there that you need to change if you're going to use the 12th. So I'll show you that a little bit later. But one of the things about an online class that you have to remember is that you have to kind of take initiative on these areas. So let's look at participation. This is one area of the syllabus that I'd like to highlight for you, if you don't mind, and talk about what contributes to participation. If you go to the grade distribution area, you'll see that 25% of the class is actually participation. And that is two things. 8 discussion boards that you write, as well as completing your home page and picture, and that's 50 points. But the vast chunk of this is the 200 points for the discussion board. While I'm here on this site, I just want to show you also notice that 30% of the class is what you write about in terms of Raisin in the Sun, a review that you write on a film that you've seen, and a review that you write on a play that you've seen. Okay, so that is the biggest chunk of the class, 30% of the writing assignments. And then there are 10 quizzes that you do, which serve for 20%, as well as 2 exams for 25%. So let me go through these in a little bit more detail for you. Back to our area here of the discussion boards. This is the participation area that I wanted to focus on with you. So there's 25 points available for each discussion board, and make sure that you put these discussion boards into the correct forum. The web page is basically 50 points that you put on the front page. Why should you watch the broadcast? Let me ask that question here first, because that is an essential one that I think you should be clear on. The reason is, on the broadcasts, I put together focus items. Oh, and there's a perfect example of it. Thank you. The discussion board focus items will be highlighted like that. See how they have that orange or yellow area? So in our discussions, you won't see it today because there's no discussion board due to for this week. But starting next week, you will see occasionally this focus item will come up. And that will mean that this topic that we're talking about at that point is something you can write about on the discussion board. So what I'm saying is you have to watch the broadcast in order to find out what you can write about on these discussion boards. Now, if you can't see the broadcast, I understand you may have conflicts We are going to be sending the recorded version of this broadcast later in the day back onto the Blackboard site, back onto the weekly modules. Let me take you to that module and I'll show you exactly where we're talking about here. So here's that opening page again. Right under here, weekly modules, this is like your, this is the pavement that's going to take you to success, all right? I have a syllabus that has a very detailed daily schedule, but it's these assignment pages, we call them weekly modules, that outline exactly what you have to do each week. So for instance, last week, that's why this is called week zero, getting started, I have a number of things like how to purchase your textbook here, the 13th edition. And I have an indication here about if you use the 11th or 12th, make sure you use the right heading. Here's the book that we're reading, The Script of a Raisin in the Sun, which you can buy almost anywhere. In fact, I think you can even find that online. So purchase your book. Here's information about the quizzes and the discussion boards. Here's the syllabus, the guidelines, how to view a class. So you can click on this link and find out all the details about how to do that. My office hours, I actually have an office hour every Tuesday from 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock before I come over here. That will be, from noon to 1 o'clock, noon to 1 o'clock on every Tuesday. And it's on Zoom. So I don't know if you've used Zoom before, but when you go up to this link right here, the Zoom office hour, it'll take you into a meeting with me if you have a question you want to ask face to face. So yeah, if you've never used Zoom before, maybe you want to use that next Tuesday. So let me go to next week's module, or this week's module. So here we are, January 23rd, and here is intro week. So every week is a new list of what you need to do for that week. This week is pretty easy. I'm using these first 2 weeks as kind of introduction weeks. So you really don't have anything that you have to read. I'm asking you, for instance, here to just go on to Blackboard and get familiar with the site, visit each button on the panel over here, click on the home page button that's right here so that you can enter your own information about yourself as well as a picture of yourself, right? Actually, that's 50 participation points, not 30. I'll fix that. And then this is watch the broadcast on Tuesday, January 23rd from 3 o'clock, which is what you're doing. So that's great. I often include a lecture, so you can download this and read this for yourself. Here's some interesting reading and media. So for instance, this week we are looking at camera angles, camera shots. So here are some YouTube videos that you can look at to kind of reinforce what we just learned. And here is where later on today, the recording of broadcast number one is going to appear. So, and remember that this is for every week. This is first week here. We're going to do the same thing next week in week two, where we're going to give you the information of what you have to do for this week, watch the broadcast, take the first quiz, and as I say here in the quiz, I should give you some more information about the quizzes too, that the quizzes are meant to be a learning experience. So the quiz can be taken over a number of times. It's not really a testing of you, it's in fact, I guess a devious way to get you to read the textbook, take the quiz before the broadcast so that if you can see the broadcast, you can contribute to it. So the quizzes are not available after 3 o'clock on Tuesday. So, and that's all indicated in the weekly modules. Next week, we're going to look at three great musicals. Here's a PowerPoint about it. I thought that for the first 2 weeks, it might be advisable to to kind of ease into the class. So I know that students in the past have really enjoyed looking at musicals. So next week, we're going to look at three musicals that have really made their mark in America, Chicago, West Side Story, and Rent. We're going to look in some detail about those. In fact, on the website on that week for next week, I actually have under media, you can look and see these three musicals. I have them in their entirety as MP4s. So feel free to watch the whole show if you'd like beforehand. So yes, these weekly modules are really the route that you want to take. In fact, next week when we finish the broadcast, here's where the recording of it is going to go. For those of you who weren't able to see the live broadcast, this is where you would see the recording. So as I was saying, next week we're going to look at three very popular shows, but the week after we're going to continue talking about musicals, and we're going to actually try to, in an hour and a half, look at the history of musicals. Not with any intention to cover all the hundreds and hundreds of shows. My gosh, just the 1920s, there were 400 musicals just in that decade. So there's no way we could cover it all, obviously. But I'm just going to kind of jump around decade to decade to give you a little sense of how interesting it's been that musicals really reflect America of that time and tells a kind of story of our history while we are enjoying singing and dancing, but there's also a lot of social information that comes in on that musical. So next week and week three, we're going to kind of take it easy and look at musicals. Although in week three, if I can take you back to the weekly module, again, this is a kind of an orientation class. Here's week three. It's not for a while yet, but as you'll see, there's a lot to do. This is where you're going to read your first chapter in the textbook. Read chapter 12 on musical theater in Wilson's The Theater Experience. In fact, I even have in here, in case you are using the 12th edition, that's chapter 13, not chapter 12. So I'm just concerned that you're not going to get messed up on the change. And then here is the textbook quiz that you take by clicking below on the music theater quiz. So when you look down here, you're going to see here's the quiz for that week that you would take. And again, as it says, you may take the quiz more than once if you think you will improve your score. But in this case, as in every Tuesday, the quiz is due at 3 o'clock, and then your highest score will be your final score. And again, the recording will be placed here of the broadcast in case you missed it. There's PowerPoints in here. Here's a lecture on musicals. And let me talk a little bit about the discussion board too, because this will be your first discussion board posting in that week. So even though it's not until week three that we're going to do this, the basic discussion board postings for the class are very much the heart of what makes this participatory, if you will. In fact, I'm going to just jump here a little bit and show you back on the main page. If we go here, you can see guidelines here on the left-hand side. When you click on this, guidelines, you're going to get another document that looks like this, the Writing Guidelines for Theater 100. And in here, please do read what our intentions are, which are to help you get more self-expression and self-esteem, being more organized. Here's the standards for grading. And as you see, we are asking you to be able to deal with some of those problems that will make your sentences kind of chop up. So fixing run-on sentences and fragments are part of what the requirement for writing are. Here's a good example that you could read to show well-organized writing. But I want to really draw your attention right now to writing in the discussion board, because the discussion board is really not like a text. If you want to focus here for a minute, it's really not like you're on your phone, okay? It's an essay. It is What I ask for is at least 100 words. So that's about 5 sentences, perhaps. So after you watch the broadcast and you find out, oh, one of the discussion board items that he's talking about is believability as an actor. Let's say that was one of them. So maybe that's one you want to write about. So you'll read that chapter when we are up on the chapter of acting and what they say about acting. So that should help you to write your discussion board posting about what you think contributes to being believable on stage, or why some actors seem so true to life in the way that they perform. You might give examples of actors who you feel really have that sense of believability. So that's your reflection, and it should be at least 100 words, only to force you to go into some depth and to express it as more than just a general comment. You want to be specific. You want to use examples and perhaps focus on what makes it important, not just what it is. So that's the heart of the reflection. And then by Friday night, midnight, you have to also respond to someone else's reflection. So if someone else perhaps wrote about, maybe there was a different discussion board focus that week on something about actors doing dialects. I don't know. I haven't actually figured out that week yet. You might want to respond to that student's comment that they wrote in the discussion board about handling dialects. And again, we're asking you to go 100 words for the response as well, so that you go into some depth. So this is a pretty significant writing exercise, using these discussion boards in the class. It is an online class, so where else do we get interaction but with these 8 discussion boards that are done in the class? So you please look at the guidelines so that when you do, you'll be able to find out what the goal of the guidelines are. And I give you a number of examples. Here's one example here, for instance, of what would contribute to a good discussion board posting. Here's the basic content that I just talked about. So please look this over and be aware that we are certainly not looking for you to just copy something from a website and put it into your discussion board. We are looking for your original thoughts, what you think about the topic. And again, as I've mentioned earlier, the style should be like writing an essay for an exam. It should not be something like a text message. We are looking for you to not have run-ons and fragments and wordiness. So it's something that you might want to create in a Microsoft Word document and then paste in to the discussion board. And here's the rubric for the discussion board, the 25 points. Basically, it's like 15 points for the reflection and 10 for the response. But here is how you can see what your grading will be for it. And let me also just show you, when you want to do your discussion board, here is the location for posting your discussion boards. When you click on this, you'll actually come to another page, and every one of these forums, as we call them, is designed for you to do your discussion board posting. So there's 8 total, right? Starting with that one I just mentioned on musical theater, which would be February 9th. So you've watched the broadcast, you found out what are the discussion board items, and then you write about them by February 9th. Hopefully this is clear. And I just want you to also know that in the weekly modules, just to make it simpler, I actually, at the bottom of the weekly modules, give you a discussion board link. So you can actually go into the discussion board that way as well. But this is probably the simplest way, so that you're aware of your footing, if you will, in the course. Okay, we've covered a lot, and I think if you just spend a little bit of time reading about these items, you'll do well in the class. How do you do well in an online class when there's no teacher that you see face-to-face? For those of you who have not taken an online class before, I can tell you it has to do with taking the initiative to read the materials that the teacher has provided. And even though mine are rather lengthy, it's giving you the whole banana there for you to understand what's expected. And I feel that that's part of my responsibility, is that in order to make it fair to everyone, you should know what's expected of you. So that's the reason why they may be a little long, some of these guidelines that I offer. Also, don't want to forget this, but you have two papers to read, to write in this class too. We will talk about that once we get to it, but just to show you where they are on the guidelines, writing a character analysis is one thing we're going to do not too far from now, after you read Raisin in the Sun and you choose a character from that play to write a character analysis on. The guidelines tell you how to do it, so please spend time looking at the tips that it gives you on how to analyze a character by, for instance, their visual appearance, or by what another character may say about that person, or what they say about themselves. And then there's what dramatic action they do. So these are suggestions to help you in your analysis, so that when you write your character analysis, you're not just taking it from e-notes, right? You're writing your own view of this. So that is one writing exercise, your character analysis. Another is when you go to see a film and a stage play, I ask that you look for a feature-length film that you go to see and use these guidelines to help you write it. So for instance, you may be aware here that we're looking at, it's got to be at least 500 words, double-spaced, for you to go into any depth about it. And the way that you can go into depth about it is by asking yourself some of these questions. Now, you don't have to answer every one of these questions. Your review would be 10 pages long if you did. But after you've seen a film, and I'm going to ask you to write one for a film and one for a play, a live play that you see, you can use these tools to ask yourself, what significance does the title have? If you go and see a play, like I mentioned earlier, Sweat, you have to ask yourself, well, why did she call it Sweat? What's in that that is significant to the playwright? That may be something that you would want to write about in your analysis, in your review. Or you may focus perhaps on how the play is about conflict, or maybe some of the interesting costumes or makeup work. So these are meant to be just tools to help you analyze the productions that you're seeing, one being a film, one being a stage play. All right, so that may look a little daunting to you, but I try to provide you with a lot of tools to help you in writing these two rather large assignments, the film review and the stage reviews. Just want to complete this by talking about the quizzes. We had mentioned that you're going to take two exams for the class, but the quizzes are all from those specific chapters that we read that week, and the weekly modules tell you exactly what to look at, but the quizzes have to be done by 3 o'clock of that broadcast day, Tuesday. The midterms and the final exams are also taken mainly from the textbook. So I've provided you with a study guide to help you know exactly what to look for in the midterm and the final exam. So if I can just bring you back here to the computer for a moment again, on the main page under study guides, you will find a document that is basically a chart showing, for instance, when we read chapter one, these are the items that you should really be able to remember and identify. Now, obviously, the midterm and the exam are going to be online, so you can have your textbook open, right? Nobody's going to to see what you're doing. But as you read the chapters to get prepared for the midterm, in this case, chapter one is going to be on the midterm, not on the final, these items are what you want to know. So these charts are here to help you. And I will draw attention to something we're going to do in the second half today. We're going to look at these items that are right here, which are going to be used on the exams. So we've got some film shots to look at here. But you'll see under every chapter, you have a list to help you focus on what's important in that chapter. All right, so this study guide should give you some assistance as you are preparing for the midterms. I showed you the grade distribution, the weekly schedule at the bottom of the syllabus is worth having. However, let me just warn you that it's all the same information that is on those weekly module pages. So you may want to print it just to get the general view of it, but your true guide is the weekly modules. If you follow that, you're going to be fine. Okay, well, just to finish, before we take our break, I just want to say, how are you going to get an A in this class? Read this material and know what's coming. In an online class, you really have to be more responsible than you would be in a face-to-face class. So it's worth your while right now, while you don't have to read anything in the textbook this week, to get a good read of what there is there in the syllabus, the guidelines, check out that study guide, but also know what you're going to be expected when you write those discussion board postings as well as the quizzes. So, and the other thing is getting things done on time. So doing your assignments on time is very crucial. In terms of late work here, if you contact me ahead of time, that's great. I'm totally willing to adapt for you if you need some more time to do an exercise, but you just can't come at the end of the semester and say, oh, I never did my film review, can I still do it? If you do it, you'll probably just get half points for it, but I do want everyone to do all the work of the class. But it makes more sense to stay up with it, especially that those weekly modules are planned there for you to be able to follow the class easily. All right, so if you have any questions, feel free to type it here and I can let everyone know the answer to it. Sorry that it's that kind of dry information about what the class is going to be like, but I think in the second half you'll enjoy looking at some examples of film clips so that we can get a real sense of what makes film unique in the way that it uses a camera to tell a story. So I hope you'll join us for the second half. I look forward to filling you in a little bit more on some camera techniques for Theater 100.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it the results are better academics, more social, better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it. Thank you.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and he was like, "Nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know."
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Zanaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Bill DeLuca for Theater 100. Welcome back to our class on television, film, and theater. We spent the first half looking a little bit at the requirements for the course for our students who are enrolled in the class. We have a good 45 students enrolled in this. So I wanted to clarify for them some of the requirements that are coming up that they would have to do. But let's have some fun looking at film, introducing our look at the film here. And feel free to either call us at 1-800-339-1193. That's a toll-free number. So, or you may want to do what Roberto did earlier and log on to askdhtvlive@gmail.com to post a question or insight. We'd love to hear from you. Especially for such an interesting topic as an introduction to film basics, which will start us on an interesting path this semester of exploring film. So we're going to look at a lot of the types of shots that are used in film just to help us develop for ourselves a little bit of an understanding of the art of watching films. You know, we have no problem going to a film and saying, "Oh, I really love that film, that was great." So it's not a question of liking or not liking. It's a question of being specific on why we thought it worked. So that's, in a way, hopefully going to increase your enjoyment of film if you have a little kind of handle on what contributed to the artistry involved in making it so fantastic. that's why we're going to spend some time with analyzing film techniques. And feel free again to submit some of your responses. I'd love to hear from you. The question we're going to pose for you is, what makes film unique? We talked about what makes theater unique. We talked about the immediacy of film, that live connection with the audience and the actor. But what does make film unique? Seems like a pretty simple question, but what do you feel really draws your interest in watching films? So again, we covered theater. Let's do the same for film and find out what we think makes that distinctive. So one of the things that does make film unique is how the camera is used to tell the story. And it's not just simply capturing the what happens of the scene and recording it so that somebody can see it later on. It's how the camera becomes an active player in interpreting what's going on. So don't think of the camera as just this technological object in the hands of a very good cinematographer. Obviously, it will become a creative tool. So that's what we're hoping to look at. First of all, I think you all know that a shot is defined as a single, uninterrupted running of the camera. So as soon as you hit record and then stop, you've done a shot, right? So, and there's a variety of shots that make it very distinct from theater. Some of the first components have to do with your distance from the subject. So if you're far away or if you're close, that's going to determine the difference between using an establishing shot or a medium shot or a close-up. So these three shots are what we're going to look at right now. The establishing shot, the medium shot, and the close-up. There's a good establishing shot. We know we're on the outside, so we're looking at a restaurant exterior. We don't even need to see the central character who might be sitting in there. We just know this is where it's going to take place. So sometimes a long shot will just establish the location and often add some atmosphere, important feeling of that place, but it just tells us where we are and it helps the audience to know something that is important for them to know. So it's not just done as a rule, it is perhaps a natural rule that it helps orient the audience to knowing where they are in terms of the environment, in terms of the setting. Once we go into that restaurant, now we are going to have a medium shot. This is where you're going to see the characters, but in their environment still. We're seeing where they are. So it's usually framed, in this case, the framing starts at the waist. So we get to see the background and we are still in the where, if you will, of the character. So that's what a medium shot does. It kind of focuses us now on the character, but in their environment. As different from a close-up, which obviously now is going to bring that camera so close that we're going to get a tight frame around Jack Nicholson as he bursts through the bathroom door, right? And close-ups can be frightening, like this one is, certainly. But usually, if you're doing close-ups of Meryl Streep or whatever, you want to show some kind of intimate connection with the audience so that you're getting a sense of what the character's feeling. That face should be telling us a lot of what's going on inside. So it's almost becomes a little more internal than those perhaps more technical long shots that we were seeing. So if you're focusing on group interaction, yes, you don't want many close-ups. You want to use more of those medium shots. Whereas if you're focusing on individuals, then you're going to get a lot of close-ups. So it's almost a given in terms of which type of shot you want to use in your film. So here's some examples. Let's take a look at some examples. This first clip, I don't know if you've seen this show. It's pretty old. Chocolat, a very young Johnny Depp and quite a wonderful Juliette Binoche. There's a scene here where you're going to see Juliette Binoche walk out of the house into the patio where there's going to be a party, and she's carrying, I forget what's on the dish. So we're very much getting a kind of establishing shot of the general setting, right? Then we're going to move to a more medium shot. I believe it's going to be Johnny Depp and Juliette Binoche together, so you're getting more information about them. And then, as you'll see, we're going to get close-ups of the people at the table that are telling us information about what they think of each other. So watch as the camera will vary from establishing shot to medium shot to close up in this wonderful little sequence from Chocolat.
Bon appétit, everyone!
If the Comte finds out...
The Comte isn't here. He wasn't invited.
Is you coming?
When you want important information about reactions, you get to that close-up. That's part of the grand artistry that a good cinematographer or director work out. How are we going to shoot this? And as we said earlier, a lot of what contributes to a close-up is the fact that you have an actor who knows how to create a sense of intimacy with the audience. Here's a scene from a wonderful film. I don't know if you've ever seen I Am Sam, but Sean Penn was... wonderful in this show. He is a intellectually challenged young man who has a daughter, Dakota Fanning, and she is refusing to learn to read because she's afraid that she's going to read better than he is capable of reading. So I think the love between them shows beautifully in this wonderful intimate scene. But notice how you couldn't have shot it any other way but with a close-up on them. So this is from I Am Sam.
I'm stupid.
You are not stupid.
Yes, I am.
No, you are not stupid, because you can read that word.
I don't want to read it if you can't.
No, because it makes me happy. It makes me happy hearing you read. Yeah. It makes me happy when you're reading.
They perched in silence for a long time. How can we be so different and feel so much alike, Newsplitter?
So you see how a close-up works so well there. If you've never seen I Am Sam, you should. In fact, here's another clip from it, but I'm going to use it just to show you that focus is basically one of the major requirements, and one of the elements of focus is the different kind of lenses that can be used to bring focus. So here's a little clip from I Am Sam, and notice how the foreshortened lens that is used makes the buildings in the distance look like they are right on top of Sean Penn as he's walking down the street. This is a short clip, but it's a good example of a foreshortened lens.
Stand head in hand, turn my face to the wall. If she's gone, I can't go on, feeling 2 foot small.
The choice of that lens was just to show him lost in this suburban world and make you feel sorry for him to some extent. So, yeah, drawing empathy for your characters has a lot to do with what lens you choose. Sometimes it's just informational. Here's a clip from a movie called That Thing You Do, which is kind of like about a group, kind of like the Beatles getting started, the early days of a group becoming popular, very much American story. But notice how this tiny clip gives you a wide angle lens so that you get all the information that you need to contribute to where this man works for his job. So this is a short clip from That Thing You Do.
Morning.
I said it was going to be a short clip, right? But that wide angle, you needed that to show how he was going to get lost in this department store that he was working in. And until he gets a job, on his band and becomes very popular and famous. So that wide-angle lens was needed to show how small he is in this vast world. So just the choices of a lens are going to say a lot. Also, a third factor is the angle that you use in a camera shot. How high or low the camera is set to the subject, and it could be a human being that you're focusing on or an object, will tell the information differently. So let's look at the example of what happens when the camera is set very low looking up at something. Here's a shot, well, there's an example right there. Don't you feel like intimidated by these guys looking down on you? You feel very small. So a low angle shot makes the subject kind of look like a giant. So here's a little clip from Chocolat, which will show you the child's point of view when she meets the mayor who was actually Alfred Molina, but you can see he looks like a giant looking over her. So this is a little clip from Chocolat.
Name?
Anouk. What's yours?
I am the Comte de Lano, at your service.
A real one? Like the Comte de Monte Cristo?
Ah, he was not a real one.
To what do we owe the...
And in that film, you'll find that a lot of the story is about him being such a huge person in the beginning, and then gradually he kind of gets taken down. So the size, in a way, was very important to start with. So if you're shooting from a low angle, you're going to make that subject seem like he's bigger than life. Whereas if you do the opposite and do a high angle shot, shooting down from above, you're going to make the subjects, like these poor guys, seem very small. All of a sudden, their bodies are smaller than they actually are because of that angle. So notice if we show this little quick clip of an old Woody Allen film called Purple Rose of Cairo, how the guests seem so small and insignificant in this little short clip of a high angle shot from Purple Rose of Cairo. Yeah, I'm using very short clips today, but Woody Allen definitely wanted it to be a very high shot to kind of show them like ants running around there. He didn't want to have any character definition as to who was who. So where you shoot from and what angle you shoot from tells a lot of information. Again, what makes film unique? This is part of what contributes to it. There's an overwhelming sense of reality that comes with film, and that is very true in terms of its difference from theater. Theater may involve actors talking right at you, which, what we say, breaks the fourth wall. In film, you're usually, even if you're looking at a sci-fi film that takes place in a future world, you still treat it realistically. And that is what's wonderful about film. It can deliver that compelling look of a real environment. Even though film inherited realism from theater, it has totally surpassed theater in being able to convey that kind of realism. Also, realize that a film is, you know, one of the things that makes film unique is that it is very visual. You have to tell the story in pictures, in film. Whereas in a play, you may go to a play that is 2 hours, and the majority of that 2 hours are people talking. So a playwright has to write a good 80 pages of dialogue to fill out that 2 hours on stage. In a film, if you were to take a Shakespeare play and want to do it on film, you probably only use about a quarter of the lines. You couldn't possibly do all of a Shakespeare production. And so that's because in order for it to be successful, it's got to be visual. It has to convey more visual than not necessarily audio, because you also have to have great sound in film, but dialogue. It kind of diminishes the dialogue. Okay, the other thing about camera work, and this is what makes film, this is what makes the movies, is when the camera itself can move. Once we start moving the camera, it allows the audience member to become part of the scene. Here's a great schematic that shows you the difference between panning and tilt. When that camera is on a tripod and you can shift it left or right, you're panning. Whereas if you can tilt it up or down, you are tilting. So pan laterally versus the vertical tilting is one aspect that gives the camera a little bit of life. Here's again, we're just looking at some quick examples, if you will. Here's a pan shot from Casablanca, the famous Humphrey Bogart film. So here's an example of a pan shot from Casablanca.
Yes, monsieur. I reserve the table. Victor Laszlo.
Yes, monsieur Laszlo. Right this way.
So you can see how that pan brought the characters in and actually moved it to the piano player. So it had a great storytelling function. Tilt, again, tilting down or up can also tell a function. Here's a little quick clip of a tilt from Truly Madly Deeply. Yeah, other than that flash shot on Juliet Stevenson, the initial tilt from the guitar playing and traveling up so slowly, that is technically a tilt, but it gives the camera a sense of motion. So when the camera's moving, you're moving along with it to some extent. You're partially a follower, if you will. But nowhere is that more evident than when we start putting the camera and its tripod on what in theater we would call a dolly, basically a platform with wheels. So now we could run it on a track or have it free form movement. And once that camera now can start moving, we get the most amazing effects. So the famous scene of Rocky running up to the art museum, and you're running right alongside him on 9th Street in Philadelphia. You are actually there participating in the action. You are moving. So a dolly shot is very compelling to create participation in the part of the audience who is sitting in a darkened theater, but it gives you the sense that you're joining in. Back to Amelie, which is a wonderful, wonderful French movie, but here is a very unique example of what happens when you can put a camera on wheels and move it around such that you tell the story from various different angles. So you can see, as the participant, you're almost riding along in this scene from Amelie. That's just exquisite. And just to turn the dolly, obviously it was an automated, it was not just a little track with wheels, but to be able to turn it at the end so that you could catch Audrey Tautou running down the street and picking up that suitcase that fell off of the motorcycle. This, we don't think of it when we watch it, we just kind of engage and follow the story. But when you really put it together and see what went into that shot, you get a little more of the artistry of what's going on. So that was a great example of a dolly or a tracking shot. And of course, when instead of putting it just on a dolly, you put it on a crane and are able to literally fly your audience member who's seeing it from all different perspectives, then you have something that is really compelling. I'm using Amelie again to show you another unique example that they've used to show a crane shot. This is from Amelie.
Monsieur,
That was an edit there at the end when they broke away from the crane shot and just gave you a close-up of the book. In fact, we're going to spend a lot of time separately talking about editing, because that's, most people think it's just, you know, cutting one shot and then putting another shot in, but editing is very artistic, very creative in terms of how you put these shots together and match them so that they blend so easily. So that was a great edit there. But did you notice the use of the crane, which first of all shows us the top of the roof, and then as the camera descends on the crane, it floats around Amelie to give us a perspective of what she's looking at in that book. So it's just amazing what you can do to help the audience feel part of it. And that is what's behind a lot of these wonderful technical shots is, as I was saying earlier to Roberto, you want to be moved by what you're seeing. So a lot of these technical solutions aren't just to kind of show off their technique as much as it is to bring you, the audience member, into the experience. It's quite wonderfully done. Speaking of editing, there's a lot that can be done also with fade-ins and fade-outs. Now, that's a theater term when we take the lights down on a scene and fade out, but it's been used quite a lot in film as well. So you're going to get an example here of a fade that helps us to feel that we're moving to another space at another time. It actually gives a change of time when we use fade-outs and fade-ins. This is from a unique show directed by John Madden, who later directed Shakespeare in Love, called Ethan Frome. So this is an interesting clip that shows a fade-out. I mean, that's a beautiful storytelling device. You are getting the sense that he's looking at the map, and now it begins to fade as a train starts taking shape. So he's plotting how he's going to be getting to this location and what train he has to take. So it's a great tool. It's a storytelling tool, if you will, in film. Another rather older technique, you do still see it today somewhat, is a wipe. In the early days of film, and we'll talk about those early days, we'll look at the early history of film, they would get rid of the previous scene by literally wiping it across the space, bringing in a new scene. And Rocky Horror Show, which was meant to be a bit of a satirical comment about our sexual mores in America, made use of a lot of techniques like this, brought back some older techniques to make that a little bit of a satirical edge. So here's a little clip from Rocky Horror Picture Show, but notice the moment when the screen all of a sudden is like pushed aside and a new screen, a new image comes in. So this is from Rocky Horror, a wipe. In that case, it actually helps you to give a sense of they're traveling to a new location, and there they end up at the front of the house where they're going to meet some interesting characters. Okay, another interesting example is what happens when we go into slow motion. Slow motion is used constantly. We're almost not aware of the use of slow motion anymore because we're so used to it. But when something dramatic has to happen, obviously, it's great to watch a sports highlight, but the initial idea is to kind of hold the moment and let it slowly evolve. So I think you'll see what happens, for instance, this is from that John Madden film, Ethan Frome, but there's a climactic moment when the couple has a tragic accident sledding, and you'll see how the slow motion accentuates what's going to be quite painful. So this is from Ethan Frome. Thank you. This is one of the oldest tricks in the book. It's amazing how slow motion has been used for so long, and it is still so valuable because it makes the moment have focus. It draws out even the emotional sense of dread that's going on here. You know that this is not going to work out well because of the slowness of you're seeing their bodies floating in space. So slow motion, great technique. I want to share another wonderful clip from Amélie with you that shows the masterful use of a variety of these pieces. This is also, this is an edited version here. So you're seeing, first of all, a tilt, and then you're actually going to see a wipe that's going to bring us to a new season. You're first of all, I think, seeing the winter, and then you're going to see spring with the wipe. And then it's followed by a pan that's going to show you Amélie leaving the house and going on to her new life where she's going to work at a restaurant. And finally, we actually get an amazing zoom that comes into the restaurant and goes into a close-up that focuses on Audrey Tautou. So see if you can follow it, but it's an amazing number of camera techniques beautifully combined together. Again, this is from Amélie.
What is that? Huh? Les jours, les mois, puis les années passent. Le monde extérieur paraît si mort qu'Amélie préfère rêver sa vie en attendant d'avoir l'âge de partir. Cinq ans plus tard, Amélie est serveuse dans un café-restaurant de Montmartre, Les Deux Moulins. Nous sommes le 29 août. Dans 48 heures, le destin...
That is so beautiful. What an artistic string of shots there. But anyway, this is what contributes to making a film work so well. I wanted to show you the 180 degree rule too, and that's when you have two people sitting at a table that the camera should stay on one side so that the audience doesn't get confused. But strangely enough, a lot has changed in the industry as well. There's the 180 degree rule given as a very nice clean, that the camera should stay on that right side and not go across that section. So anyway, these are a lot of the clips that we look at when we look at the five films that we're going to focus on in Theater 100. So again, for my students, please go to the Blackboard site and read up on what's going to be required. And I will see you next Tuesday for broadcast number 2 when we start looking at musicals in Theater 100.